Blog Talk Radio.
Real radio. Real radio. Plant seed and water seed. Welcome to Real Talk Radio, the show that says just because you do not attend with them doesn't mean that you're not in him. The him being Jesus, the show that plants seeds and water seeds, but God gives the increase. Let's talk about it on Real Talk Radio. This show is a continuation of the Church Folk Revolution. Enjoy the show.
Welcome, welcome, welcome one and all to another episode of Real Talk Radio, the show that says just because you don't attend with him does not mean that you're not in him. The him being who?
Jesus.
Man, I was wondering if somebody was going to say it. Anyway, thank you all. I mean, it was a long delay. Anyway, we never claim to have all the answers here on Real Talk Radio. We some brothers who come to have discussions. This is not a Bible study show or a church show, but we do talk about the things that concern the body of Christ. And with us today, we have a special guest all the way from California. He woke up pretty early to be on air with us today to talk about his book, Jesus Untangled, the man, the legend, Keith Giles. Keith Giles. Real okay.
Wow.
From KeithGiles.com. My apologies, fellas. So, Keith, you got this new book out, man. And I've been hearing that there's a lot of people who want to interview you, but I think we got you first, man. We got you first.
You're definitely in the first. You're not the first, but you're in the first round, yes.
First round, okay, good.
Yeah.
We'll take it.
You got me before Good Morning America, which...
before you blow up.
It's
so,
coming.
You know, with all the things going on politically in America, you know, we see how we have a lot of Christians were praying for Trump, a lot of Christians were praying for Hillary. Some Christians are apolitical, like I would think that most of us on this show are apolitical. But, you know, there's a big division, you know. And so does God play political favors? Does God have a political side that he favors one over the other? So we just want to discuss that on the air today. And before we really jump into it, I want the other brothers to, you know, if you guys want to say something, go ahead, because I don't want to hog the mic, because I can. So, fellas.
Hey, man, I'm here. This is Rob, man. Just happy to have Keith back on the show with us, and we're, you know, to take this discussion into another direction from the last time he was on, but I'm very interested in hearing what the brother has to say. This definitely has been a very wild political season, more so than any in our recent history. As far as my recollection goes anyway. And I'm interested in making some heads or tails of this whole thing, man. So, Keith, glad to have you, bro.
Thank you. Thank you so much, guys.
Yeah. And this is John. For me, I was really looking forward to this show because I see so much after reading the book. I mean, it's just so plain and clear. And this book is going to ruffle some people's feathers and other people.
Yep.
Make them, you know, it's going to take some shackles off of some people. So we're just looking forward to getting it. But don't want to go too much into detail this early on, but we'll get to it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
This is Andre. You know, the Word of God is meant to ruffle feathers. It's all good. You know what I'm saying? This book is definitely going to open a lot of eyes as far as the gospel entanglement within the political system. There's just going to be some people, it's going to bring up a lot of opposition, like everyone has said so far, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, once we have matured to the point where we can see past our own cognitive dissonance we'll actually be able to see the importance of what this book is talking about. I'm really looking forward to it.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right. All right.
All right.
That it? Good. Okay. So, Keith, let me ask you a question. What this made you decide to write a book about this subject?
Yeah, well, I've been blogging for about 10 years, and over that course of time, I have noticed in conversation with people online, as well as just family members and friends of mine, just started noticing more and more how entangled Christians are with politics, and to the point where some of them are so entangled with their particular political party and their political views. You know, it's sort of like they will Christians who would never ever share their faith in Christ with anyone will at the drop of a hat argue you into the ground about politics. And so, you know, so in other words, I started realizing people are more American than they are Christian. You know, they're more likely to be emotionally moved. You know, they'll break into tears at the when somebody plays the national anthem, or you know, quotes Ronald Reagan or Bill Clinton or something. And but you know, you don't see that same kind of emotion when it comes to Jesus. And so those kinds of things, and also, you know, what I see is they're really kind of living their life much more out of their political identity than their Christian identity. So they're more American than they are Christian, and that's a real problem. And at first I just kind of noticed it. I blogged about it here and there. But over the years I've started to just feel like it's more of a danger. In other words, it's not just a little problem. It's not just, yeah, that's kind of annoying. And I think what we're seeing, the climate we're in today, should really, really put a finger on it and say, this is dangerous. This is dangerous to our nation, and it's dangerous to the church, and it does damage to the gospel. So that's really why I decided to write the book, to kind of put a spotlight on this. And my hope is that Christians who read the book, who are entangled, would realize it, and repent of it, and begin to, you know, to start really seeking first the kingdom of God and not the kingdom of America.
Mm-hmm. You know, one thing that I kind of found interesting, especially with today being Super Bowl Sunday, and a couple of Super Bowls ago we had a quote-unquote prophet to say that the Denver Broncos was going to win the Super Bowl, and they didn't. But during that, you had some people praying for one team to win and the other team praying for their team to win. And I see it the same thing that happened throughout the election process. You had Christians on the left praying for Hillary, Christians on the right praying for Trump, and thinking that, okay, God is on my side. Why do you think that is?
Well, let me tell you, that's not anything new. If you go back to the Old Testament and go to Joshua chapter 5, you'll find a really interesting scenario that takes place. So Joshua, who is you know, now the leader of the children of God, of Israel, the nation of Israel, and they're getting ready to go into battle against Jericho. And Joshua, he looks and he sees this man standing in front of him, you know, a warrior basically. He doesn't recognize. The guy's standing there in armor, and he's holding a sword. And Joshua walks up to him and says, "Are you for us, or are you for our enemies?" And who he's talking to is the commander of the army of the Lord. And the army, the commander of the army of God, you know, this basically is an angel. Mm-hmm. He looks at Joshua, and his answer is, "I am for neither, because I'm the commander of the army of the Lord, and I have come." And so, you know, think about that for a second. Joshua stands with the righteous people, the people of God, right, Israel, the nation of Israel. And he's about to go into battle against these pagans. And he asks God's angel, "Are you on my side? Are you on our side?" You know, the good people, right, the godly people. "Are you on the side of those pagans over there?" And the answer is, "I'm on neither side." And this is what we don't get, is that It's not whether or not God is on our side. The question is, are we on God's side? And that's where we get confused, and that's part of why it's dangerous, is that we start to believe that God is on our side, and therefore anything we do is blessed and sanctified and justified, you know, by God, rather than saying,
right.
Well, what does God say, and where is God standing, and why don't we join his team, rather than expecting him to join our team.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and you know, we find it like, I think another dangerous part of that is, say, the Christians on the right who voted for Trump, and when Trump won, they're like, yes, we won. So it kind of,
yeah.
I don't want to say validates them, but they say, yes, God is on our side. And we even had a post, I don't know if you know who Vicky Yoey is. She's a singer.
Mm-hmm.
But she put a Facebook, there was a big controversy. She put a post on Facebook. It had a picture of Jesus holding some suitcase talking about, I'm on my way back to the White House.
Oh, yeah.
Did,
I saw that.
Did you hear about the controversy or anything?
Well, I didn't hear the controversy. I definitely saw the picture, but here's what I find, again, that pictures like that are exactly what I'm talking about. So when, you know, someone posts a meme or a picture like that, here's Jesus packing his bags, and yeah, I'm heading back to the White House because Trump, you know, the Republican nominee won the election, and now suddenly Jesus is back in the White House. I would say, well, hang on a second. What were the things that Jesus cared about? Well, Jesus cared about the poor. Jesus cared about turning the other cheek. Jesus cared about loving your enemy. Jesus cared about, you know, all these kind of things. So is what you're saying is that Trump all of a sudden cares about the poor? Are you saying that Trump cares about loving our enemy? Are you, you know, in other words, is Trump, do we see any indication at all that Trump is interested in the agenda and the teachings of Jesus? Is Trump following, look at all these executive orders he signed. How many of those executive orders have anything to do with the agenda of Jesus? I would say not a single one of them.
Mm-hmm.
So, no. but if you're entangled in politics, and like you said, well, our guy won, therefore God is on our side, and anything he does must be what God wants to happen. Well, now you've just blessed something that Jesus would not bless, and you're even flat out putting his name on something that he would not put his name to.
Mm.
And, you know, honestly, I think that is the definition of using the Lord's name in vain.
Mm.
You are using his name for something he would not put his name to.
Wow. I never even thought about that aspect of it, using his name in vain like that. Wow. So you have Paula White. I'm pretty sure you know who Paula White is. She's has she been assigned to something in the White House with him? Is she like his chaplain or something? What does she have to do?
You know, I don't know. I don't know if I don't even know who has that position. I know Franklin Graham for the longest time, you know, Billy Graham and Franklin Graham have had positions like that. And I would imagine, I know that during the campaign, Franklin Graham and Jerry Falwell Jr., were both really buddy-buddy with him. So I'd be surprised if they weren't advisors, spiritual advisors of some kind. I don't know about Paula White, though.
Okay. Now, I do have a question. I don't want to expose too much of your book, but I lost my train of thought. It was something you had written in the book. You know what? I'll come back to it because I lost my train of thought that quick.
I got a question. Not a question, but I want to tackle the topic real quick while Jonathan's regaining his thoughts. I want to talk about this Christian patriotism, or you know how, like you said, you're more American than Christian, and so Christian patriotism is a big, I think we did a show about it a while ago. I'm not sure if we did it. Shut up, Rob.
the human archive. Go ahead.
Like, how is it that you, if you aren't a patriot or if you don't love this country the way that these Christian patriotism do, that makes you less of a Christian?
Right. Well, yeah, and you know what? This is something that I talk about in the book. there actually has been in America several different waves historically of movements where Christians and politicians have worked together and really conspired together to, on purpose, entangle Christians with politics. And it's so that it's a give and take for both sides. The Christians are interested in doing it because they get political power and favoritism, and they gain some respect in the community by being aligned with those who are in political power. Politicians get really the best end of the deal because what they get is a whole lot of votes, and that's what they're interested in. And so, and by the way, this happens on both the left and the right. But so, in other words, we have been over the years. There was a move in the 20s. There was a move again in the 50s. There was another move again in the 80s, and we're aware of that. If we lived through it, you know, with Ronald Reagan and Jerry Falwell and the religious right, a moral majority, this was not an accident. In other words, this didn't happen by accident. This was some people sitting down and saying on the political side, how can we get these Christians to vote for us? What do we need to promise them? And then if we do that, they'll vote for us. But then what happens is, and again, this happens on both the left and the right, all those promises that get made. So on the right, the promises are we're going to overturn Roe versus Wade, and we're going to, we're going to make gay marriage illegal, and we're going to protect, mm-hmm. The sanctity of marriage. Those are the two hot buttons on that side. On the left side, it's we're going to deal with the problems in the inner city. We're going to fix poverty. We're going to, improve education and get more jobs and whatever. So they make those promises, but when they get in office and they get in power, all you hear is crickets because they got what they wanted. Yeah. And I talk about in the book, it's sort of like this shiny red button that they hold out that whatever that issue is, that's the button they hold out during election season. And we all go out there and hit that button because, we care about that. But they're not interested in taking that button away. The minute they solve our problem, the minute they fulfill their promise, well, they've lost their leverage. What are they going to do the next time it's an election season? Mm-hmm. What are they going to promise us? There's, unless they get something to replace it with, they're not interested in solving that problem. So that there's been this unfortunately, and again, I document all this in the book. That this has happened on purpose. This has been a strategy that people have employed, that we've ended up where we are today.
Mm. Yeah, that actually is what I was going to talk about. That is, you brought it right up. So that is what I'm going to talk about. Them making promises to us, especially the Roe versus Wade, because I just read yesterday, I voted for Trump because he's a Republican and they're against abortion. I read that yesterday,
right.
And that is one of the only things that they can say today, because like you said, abortion and gay marriage, they try to say it was conservative value. And like you said, they never do it. How many Republican candidates have we had in office
right.
who, were against it? And I fell for that. I voted for Bush twice. Because of that reason, those two reasons specifically. So I was bamboozled by that. And I fit right into what you said. I'm guilty.
And you're not alone. You're not alone. A lot of people have.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Say again, John.
I'm just saying, it's a carrot and a stick.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about.
Exactly.
Well,
it's the carrot and the stick.
What's the stick part of it?
To hold the carrot out. You on back of the donkey. You never seen.
No, fool. The stick.
No. You don't know the carrot and the stick. You sit on the back of the donkey. You hold you the stick to hold the carrot out in front of the donkey to make the donkey do what you want him to do.
Okay.
Goodness gracious.
Well, but a lot of what it is too, and I talk about this in the book, a lot of the motivation is, so I'd say the carrot is the promise of this, we're going to solve this problem for you, but I think the stick, the threat, is fear, and fear is the main thing they use to motivate. I'm still on email lists for both conservative and, conservative Republican and liberal Democrat, like mailing lists. And really all they are is fundraisers, but both of them employ the exact same tactics. So I get to read them, I read them all the time, and I just shake my head because people fall for this, the headline is something like that, basically, you know, if we don't stop them, the liberals are going to do this, and if we don't stop, and if we don't act now, the conservatives are going to, you know, destroy this. And so it's this fear. They're motivated by fear. You've got to send money. You've got to call your congressman. You've got to vote, because if we don't, they're going to just take over and they're going to win, you know. And so that really the fear is the stick, you know, the fear of what America is going to become if you don't vote this way or send money or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And really, and I talk about this in the book as well, ultimately, whether you're left or you're right, it's a manipulation, but it's also something called tribalism. And tribalism, at its core, is something that no Christian should really be a part of. Tribalism is a natural thing for us to do. We just naturally do it, I think, as human beings. You know,
mm-hmm.
kind of like, hey, it's my family, or it's my neighborhood, or my community, or my city. Again, the Super Bowl is going on today, so it's my team. Or it's my political party, or it's my nation. And at any rate, whatever it is, whatever your tribalism, however you identify yourself, once you've strongly identified yourself with a particular tribe, well, then what you end up doing is, because now there's a very strong us, that means everybody who's not us is them. And then what you start doing is you start saying, well, those people over there, they're bad. They're evil. Everything they do is evil. Everything they think, all of their motivations are twisted. And you see this on Facebook. I'm sure you guys have seen this. I see it all the time where, you know, people will post things or just make comments about, oh, you know, to a liberal, this is this, or, you know, to a Republican, they all think this. But it's that language of saying they're all like this, or they all think this way, or they all have this, you know, motivation in their heart. Well, of course they don't. But by painting them with this big, broad brush, and now you get to label them as people who are completely at their core, they're evil, they want evil things, they're foolish, they're stupid, they're ignorant, they're misguided. You start labeling them with all these things. Well, now, once you've done that, then anything you do or say against them, any action you take to stop them is sanctified and justified because they are beyond redemption because of that, because of the way you painted that picture. But the gospel says no one's beyond redemption. The gospel says that everyone has an opportunity to be transformed by the love of Christ. So if you're playing in that tribalistic game, this is one of the things where, you know, that tribal thinking begins to invade your heart and to change the way you think, the way you see people. You now mm-hmm. look at people and you label them. And if that person doesn't think the way you do politically, they're yep. in a different political party, they could be a brother in Christ. But you would then think things about them that are not true, and you would treat them in a way that, frankly, we shouldn't treat people. And I got to say one more thing. I realize that, you know, so within the church, within the body of Christ, Christians treat other Christians this way, think horrible things about them, get into horrible arguments, you know, friendships are broken, families are divided over mm-hmm. these political arguments.
Yeah.
You know, Paul said in 1 Corinthians, when he wrote a letter to the church in Corinth, he warned them, he forbid them. He said, you know, I'm hearing that some of you in the church say, I follow Paul, and others say, I follow mm-hmm. Peter, and others say, I follow Apollos. In other words, they were dividing, they were tribalistically dividing over which apostle was their favorite. And Paul said, absolutely not. You are all one in Christ. You know, I wasn't crucified for you. Peter didn't rise from the dead for you. Apollos mm-hmm. didn't die on the cross for you. Jesus did, and you are all followers of Jesus. And he refused to allow Christians to separate their fellowship over which apostle they liked better. So how in the world today do we justify disfellowshipping other Christians, breaking fellowship with other Christians, and even our own family members, because we disagree about politics? I mean, absolutely not. There's
but
no
you know
room
what?
At all for that.
When you think about it, Keith, we do the same thing over doctrines. and denominations
yes.
as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
yes,
you
yes.
know, I think back when I was in the church way back when, and I had made this statement to somebody. I said, I think it would be harder for me to marry somebody of another denomination than for me to marry an unbeliever. I think
oh, yeah.
that marriage would be worse off than me marrying somebody who didn't believe at all. And that's a fact.
Yeah.
And I think that still rings. And I was in the church when I was saying that. You know, like
oh, yeah.
if I marry a Baptist or this type of person, then we're going to be fighting over doctrine all the time, fighting over the kids,
right.
what we believe, do we speak in tongues,
do we
not
tithe?
Speak in tongues. Right, do we tithe? Well, we were going to tithe. I was tithing back then. But just the different doctrines that denominations believe in and teach, you know, I said that would be a harder marriage to live in than me living with somebody who does not believe at all. You know, and that's,
right, and you know that's yeah, you're exactly right. That it's just another form of tribalism. Denominations like that, you know, Methodist, Baptist, Lutheran, Pentecostal, Presbyterian, whatever. Those are man-made divisions, right? What was when Jesus prayed for us? When Jesus prayed for the church, what did he pray? That they would be one, even as he and the Father are one. We're the ones, and I have a little cartoon in the book that I got from this guy. I love him. He does these great cartoons. But in the cartoon, it's all these guys with these giant pencils, and they're all drawing boxes
yep.
around themselves. And
yep.
Jesus is standing
it.
There with a giant pencil, but he's got an eraser, and he's erasing
yep.
all the lines.
Yep.
And
that's
everybody's really
staring
what's
at
going
him.
On. Yeah, we're
and
the ones drawing
the
lines.
Man.
We're the ones dividing. And Jesus is the one erasing the lines and saying, no, you're all one in Christ. But we're the one dividing each other. And that's why, yeah, I think those things shouldn't matter. You know, of course we disagree on certain things, but nothing should ever, you know, 1 Corinthians is a great book for that. I mean, Paul just hits that over and over again. You know, he even talks about how they were suing each other in court over things, and he said, you know what, why not rather just be wrong? Just be wrong, because it's more important for there to be unity in the body than for you to be right and divide the body.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it definitely goes across many other lines, you know, we have a problem with this.
Yeah, something else about that picture too is, you know, if when you guys get the book and read it, you know, that picture you can see where Jesus is erasing the lines and everybody else is drawing. Everybody is staring at Jesus like, "What is he doing? What are you doing? Erasing
right.
these lines? We got these lines." But that's how we treat each other, you know. If you trying to unify about, or you're doing something different than the status quo, then people are going to look at you like, what are you doing, man? What are you saying? And when we
right.
come out of the institutional church system, people look at you the same way. What are you doing? What do you mean? You can't, you know, we have this structure, and you're trying
yeah.
to say, you know, come out of the structure. What are you doing? And I noticed that about
oh, yeah.
that picture as well.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a powerful one. I love it. It's a great one.
So
mm-hmm.
okay, so I have a question. Okay, are you? I'm quite sure that you're familiar with the whole dominionist point of view, the one that pretty much states that in order for Jesus to actually come back to Earth, there has to be some sort of Christian takeover. There has to be a Christian takeover of the media. There has to be a Christian
mm.
takeover of this, a Christian takeover
yeah,
of
the seven mountains. The seven mountains.
The seven mountains. And so, if I remember correctly, one of those mountains was the political arena as well. Do you actually see how? What's going on in, especially in this year's? I know you've alluded to years past, like in the 80s with the Reagans and whatnot, and Jerry
yeah.
Falwell. But can you actually in this era, can you see how the dominionist viewpoint of taking over certain entities? Can you see how all of this is coming into play?
Well, yeah, absolutely, and that's why I think it's dangerous. I came across something earlier this week that someone posted, and I reposted it on my blog. It's actually a poster from the, or it's a giant sign. It's not really a poster. It's a sign that hangs in the Holocaust Museum. And it talks about the early warning signs of fascism. Fascism being, you know, basically the way of thinking and the political system that created Nazi Germany. Something we should all be very afraid of and concerned about, and something part of history we don't ever want to repeat again. And what I found really interesting in this list of the early warning signs of fascism, the very first bullet, the very first point is this: powerful and continuing nationalism. But if you scroll down a couple more, almost right in the exact middle of that list is another element, another warning sign of fascism, and that is this: religion and government intertwined. That should make us, as Christians, pause, take a deep breath, take a step back, and say, are we playing into a system that is leading us, leading America as a nation, towards something where we could end up repeating what happened in Nazi Germany? Because, I mean, if you go down the list, it actually kind of describes America right now. You know, the second bullet is disdain for human rights, identification of enemies as a unifying cause, the supremacy of the military, rampant sexism, controlling the mass media, obsession with national security, corporate powers protected, labor power suppressed, disdain for intellectuals and the arts, obsession with crime and punishment. Didn't somebody promise to be the law and order president?
Yep,
rampant
yep.
cronyism and corruption. Isn't he assigning people to his cabinet that are good friends of his and even family members? Fraudulent elections. Didn't someone claim that the election was rigged and all that? I mean, if you go down the list, you can check off the boxes. And, guys, this is America right now. And I'm telling you, what has led us to this place has been, like you're saying, this way of thinking. Franklin Graham, unfortunately, Franklin Graham has become one of the people who I don't think he understands. I really don't think he really knows what he's doing. I think in his heart he thinks he's doing a good thing. But what he doesn't understand is that he is laying the groundwork for a Christian theocracy.
Mm-hmm.
And to some people that sounds really good. You know, it's like, oh, great, Christians will have power, and Christians will have and Trump promised the church that in his campaign. He stood up in front of evangelical Christians and said, if I win the election, Christians are going to have power again. And they eat it up with a spoon. But what they don't understand is that this is what makes me so upset, guys. This is what makes me so upset. When Christians hear a political person say that, I'm going to give you power again, I'm going to give you authority again, I'm going to give you respect again, and that motivates us to vote for that person, here's why that breaks my heart. Christians, the average Christian in America, just pick any Christian on the pew anywhere in any church right now. It could be an 8-year-old girl. It could be a 90-year-old woman. It could be a 70-year-old man. I don't care. The average Christian right now in America has more power than any president to change the world, because we have Christ living in us. The same power that raised Christ from the dead is at work in every believer. We have been given a gospel designed by the greatest mind in the universe, and the purpose of that gospel, the reason it was designed, was to transform you and me into people who act like Jesus and love like Jesus, and then to transform people around us into people who look and act like Jesus. We do not need anyone to give us more power than that. We have all the power we need. And the dangerous thing is for the church to believe this lie that we need someone to give us more power, that we need someone to give us some other weapon, some other tool, you know, to do our job. I've heard so many Christians say that, oh, because Trump is president, oh, good, now we can really preach the gospel. And I'm thinking, what? You mean to tell me you haven't been able to preach the gospel until now?
Obama,
I mean, we don't live in communist China. We don't live in North Korea. What are you talking about?
Oh,
you know,
man.
Why do you need any? Why is it that the person sitting in a chair in a White House has anything to do with whether you can or you can't freely preach the gospel and live out the gospel. It has nothing to do with your calling. And, mm-hmm. and so it's just part of that deception. It's subtle. It's subtle, and it's really easy to buy into it and to think, well, that makes sense. Yeah, yeah, Christians should take over media, and Christians should take over journalism. And Franklin Graham flat out says, you know, Christians should occupy every seat of government in America, as if that's going to solve our problems. You know, people have to realize that would be the beginning of the biggest problem we have ever had.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. So let me ask you real quick, because you use a term, and you know, everybody listening may not understand what that term is. What do you mean when you say theocracy?
Okay, yeah, a theocracy is, I think it's really easy to explain it. Go and look at Iran. The nation of Iran, the whole nation, is run by a religious leader. And it's Muslim, right? It's Islam. But because a single religious leader with a particular, for Christians, we would say, a particular denomination of that religion, because, you know, even Islam has different, you know, there's liberal and conservative within Islam. So basically, if you're not a member of that particular church and that particular way of thinking, too bad, because the laws are going to be such, and the police are going to enforce the laws of that religion. And so you basically, by law, are forced to obey the rules and regulations of that religion. And if you break those rules and those laws of that religion, you will be arrested, tortured, beaten, lose your job, thrown in jail indefinitely, because the church has control of the government. And essentially what it is, and it's why in America from the very beginning, we have this idea of the separation of church and state. And it's very much because the founding fathers did not want America to become a country that was ruled by any one religion, not by Christianity, not by Islam, not by Buddhism, not by any religion. They weren't against religion, so there were protections for the freedom of the practice of any religion or no religion at all. And that was one of the things that made America unique and special in the world, because it's really up to that point, most governments had a state church, right? England had a state church. And depending, actually, if you even look at the history of England, a very bloody history. When the king was Catholic, then the Protestants were you know, tortured and beaten and arrested and put to death. When the king was Protestant, the Catholics were beaten and tortured and arrested and put to death. And so the founding fathers said, you know what? We do not want to create a nation like that. And so that's one of the reasons why, the original design was for the state to be the state and for the church to be the church, and for those two things not to become entangled. And so, but what we see, unfortunately, right now in America is a very strong movement of evangelical Christians who absolutely do want church and state to become entangled. They absolutely do want the government to pass laws that favor Christian theology. There's no one wanting, you know, there's no great movement, to get the government in America to follow Buddhist laws or Hindu laws or things like that. It's evangelical Christianity. And more and more, if we don't back out of this and wake up and realize what those guys are doing, we could end up in a place again where we have a government that is. Here's the thing: if you're a Christian, you can look at it on one side and say, "Well, that's okay because I'm a Christian." Yeah, but it's really bad news for everybody around you who isn't a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
And forcing someone at gunpoint to pretend that they're Christian is not, that's not spreading the gospel. Passing laws doesn't change anyone's heart.
Right.
Never.
Because, you know, you have this this thing now, especially during this political season, where fear-mongers had people worried that Sharia law was coming to America. And so, it's really crazy when you have, you know, when you have fear mongering of one particular religious group, you know, and you start rounding up people according to their religious beliefs rather than according to what they may have done, it becomes really, really dangerous.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Yeah, and you know, I talk about this in the book. I quote Franklin Graham, where he had posted something a while back, where he said, you know, he made that statement about how wonderful it would be if Christians held every seat of government. And then I talk about how, like I just did, about how really that's a bad idea.
Mm-hmm.
But then I quoted, at the end, I quoted Billy Graham, his father, who said this. He said, "It would disturb me if there was a wedding between the religious fundamentalists and the political right. The hard right has no interest in religion except to manipulate it." And, you know, Franklin, I wish Franklin would listen to his father.
Yeah,
but it isn't just the right either. You know, I talk about, I'm going to say this too real quick. I talk about the right a lot in the book. I kind of point out a lot of the entanglement that's come from the religious right, from the conservative Republican side of things. I do that partly because that was my own story. I grew up in that, and I came out of that, and so I'm very, very familiar with that. I did it also because I think right now that's the branch of government and also the flavor of Christianity that is entangled with that. And so I point out that a lot more in the book, but I don't in any way want people to think that, well, the problem is the conservative Republicans, and that what we need to do then, you know, if I'm a Democrat, I'm safe, because that isn't the case. This entanglement happens on the left and the right. And we were talking before the show about the fact that, you know, there's these issues that people hold out on the political side to motivate people to vote. And the left have their issues and the right have their issues. They both have issues. The answer is not to just switch parties. The answer really is to abandon that whole political entanglement completely and to seek first the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. So one of the things I want to touch on when you were talking about earlier is you said that laws don't change people. Don't change art. It does not. What laws do is force a certain behavior to stop people from doing certain things. And we see that even in the Bible, that the law of God didn't necessarily transform people's heart. What it did was force them to act a certain way. And so what we want to do is pass laws to make people, I'm going to say we because we're Christians. A lot of Christians who are dominionists hold this viewpoint of getting all these Christians in political office. They want to pass laws to force everyone to act like Christians so that we feel more comfortable, one. And
Amen.
Two, because we said so.
Yep. I know you're right on, man. You are exactly right. And this is the real problem is that it really is about their comfort. It's really like, you know what, I want to make the world a place that I feel comfortable when I get in my car and I drive down the street. I don't like seeing mosques on the street corner. I want to see churches on the street corner. When I go to work, I don't want to work with a guy who's gay. You know, when I send my kids to school, I don't want my kids in school to be hanging out with people that believe differently than I do. So what I want is I don't like those things. Those things make me nervous. Those things make me uncomfortable. So I want to pass laws to get rid of all that so that I feel better and I live in a world where I feel better. And and that's really, I think that's the core of what it is. But the problem is by making yourself more comfortable, you're making a whole lot more other people really, really uncomfortable and really terrified, right? So they're pretending to go along with you, but in their hearts they really don't. And then what does that do to the gospel? What does that make, how does that person who's not a Christian think of Christ and think of the gospel and think of Christianity when they're in that system, right? They see you as an oppressor. They see you as a bully. And they see the gospel as like a club that's used to just make them, you know, pretend to be something they're not. And that you now you have perverted the gospel into something wrong. They have almost no chance of really sincerely becoming Christian.
Yeah, I would say some Rick Young, he's listening to us. He's Ark Studies. He's on Blog Talk, but he made a point. He said the authorized version. I guess, you know, if you look at that, you know, if we did have a theocracy over here, what if they said, well, you can only read the King James Version. If you're caught reading any other version of the Bible besides the King James Version, then you will be in jail. We will send you to to get you retrained on this, anything else. And that those are the type of things that can happen. And you hit on it, you know, you have to, with a theocracy, who, you know, is it going to be Pentecostal? You know, people who speak in tongues? What about if it's the Baptist people who are in and they'll say, well, you can't speak in tongues anymore. That's not allowed. We don't allow that in this country. You know, so that's what we have to be careful, and that's what dominionism, you know, really is about, is taking over all of that stuff, and that is so dangerous. So let me ask you, Keith, are we a Christian nation? Was this nation founded by Christians, the founding fathers and all this good stuff? Are we a Christian nation?
Yeah, I talk about that in the book, and I think this is one of the pillars, one of the real problems that most Christians in America have when we talked about this subject, because they've been told from the pulpit, and if they went to a Christian school, they were told this. Their moms and dads told them this. We have reinforced this idea for generations. America is a Christian nation, but we're not a Christian nation. Now, the way you asked the question was interesting. Were we founded by Christians? Yes. Most of the people that came over here happened to be Christians. They were Anglicans. They were Puritans. They were Quakers. Yes. They were, most of them, probably majority of them, were Christians. But the founding fathers, again, most of them were not really Christians. If you look at Benjamin Franklin, he was not. Thomas Jefferson really was not, although people will argue about that. But if you really just look at it objectively, at best they believed that there was a God. They were a deist. They thought there might be a God somewhere, but they were not specifically followers of Jesus. But even if they were, okay, if you are convinced that they were followers of Jesus, okay, fine. I'm not going to take that away from you. I don't think they were, but go ahead and let's just assume that they were. But the point is still this: the government they designed, the government that they put together, very purposely was not a Christian nation. They built into it, again, this idea of the separation of church and state, that the church was the church and the state was the state. They, you know, they could have done that. They had just come out of something like that. It would have been really easy to declare a state church and to, like you're saying, you know, say you got to read this version of the Bible and you got to go to church at least, you know, three times a month. And you got, you know, all these kind of things you got to do. They easily could have done that. It was the very beginning of the nation. And they had the power to do whatever they wanted, and they on purpose did not do that. So were we a nation of Christians? Yeah, mostly, but they were all different kinds of Christians, right? In fact, Puritans and Quakers killed each other over issues of doctrine, even when we were still a colony. And when you read things like that, you think, oh, my gosh, these people are supposed to be Christians, but they're killing one another because over issues of doctrine. Issues of doctrine like that. It's just insane. But it's examples of things like that. Again, the founding fathers knew that. They had heard about that. They had experienced that. They had seen that kind of like Christians persecuting other Christians because you're a Quaker and I'm a pilgrim, or you're an Anglican and I'm a Quaker. And so they saw that kind of stress and strife even within Christianity and the church, the Christians in the colonies. So they were like, you know what, we're done with it. We're just going to create a government. You can practice whatever religion you want. We're going to put in place freedoms for you to practice any religion you want to practice. But we are absolutely not going to have a government run by the church or dictated by the church or any of that. So, again, I know that's something really hard for Christians to accept, that we're not a Christian nation. But I would ask this question. When you say when you say America is Christian, this and this is something I run into a lot. People who do believe America was a Christian nation, they'll point to things like, well, you know, look at the mention of God in the Declaration of Independence, or look at the look at, you know, we're one nation under God and we all these kind of things. Well, here's the thing. I challenge people to do this. You know, take a highlighter, go and read the Declaration of Independence, and every time you see a teaching that comes from the Sermon on the Mount or something that was from the mouth of Jesus or something that was specifically something that Jesus taught, I want you to highlight it. When you get to the bottom, you will not have made a mark on that page because we did not, the founding fathers did not, create a government built on the teachings of Jesus. And to be Christian means to be Christ-like. This nation was never like Christ in the way we behaved, in the way we treated one another, in the way we treated Native Americans, in the way we treated slaves. That none of that was the way Jesus would have behaved. And then, you know, we have never acted like Christ. And then when we put together the document, the founding fathers put together a document to establish this nation, they did not turn to the Sermon on the Mount for any information or any ideas of how to form this nation. So we were not formed on the teachings of Christ. We are not a Christ-like nation, either in our formation of our teaching, of our of the way the government was designed, or in the way we behave or have ever behaved towards each other or to other people.
Even in that saying that a nation is a Christian or a Muslim nation, that's kind of a misnomer because nations cannot be Christian.
That's right.
The people.
Yes, I think. Yeah, do you get your Christian milk? Do you get your Christian milk from a Christian cow?
You know?
You know, I mean, that's kind of, but see, but don't Christians today, you know, that's why we go to Christian bookstores, right, and you can listen to Christian music and watch Christian movies, and you go to a Christian bowling alley and go to a Christian roller skating rink and call your Christian plumber, and, you know, because, oh, everything has to be Christian, and we have already kind of created a little bubble for ourselves as Christians, many of them,
yeah.
Where, you know, we just want a Christian version of the world. In any way we can get it. That's what we want. We just want to create a little Christian safe version of the world that we feel comfortable. But that's not reality. Like you said, those things can't be Christian. You can't have a Christian cow. You can't drink Christian milk. You can put a label on it and tell yourself it is, but in the end, it's just milk.
Right. Mm-hmm. And we see that too. With like Jonathan and I, we do stand-up comedy. And people want to label us Christian comedians. They always say, I'm not a Christian comedian. I'm a comedian that's Christian.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And something else that you brought up, you're talking about the world. I had a saying, and I've been saying it for years. I've said it on this show numerous times, that that the church is a part of the world. And when I say church, I'm talking about the institutional church. It's a part of the world system.
Yes, it is.
And it's hard for believers to actually see that because they think they're separate. But it's a part of the world system. Us as believers, we are not a part of that world system. True believers.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, and I talk about in the book about how really the church got to be a part of the world system really was under Constantine. And when he fused the church and the state together, that was really how the church became part of the world system, where the church, as we know it today, is like you said, it's part of the world system. It's connected to the government. It's, you know, it's a tool of the government, really, the way as it stands. And, you know, that's why I talk about how in the book how you cannot convert a culture if that culture has already converted you. And this is why it's so dangerous for us to say, I'm an American and I'm a patriot and I'm a nationalist. Well, because guess what? Well, now you are so a part of that system now that you're not going to help anybody else get out of it because you yourself are really enslaved by that. You know, I use the metaphor sometimes talking about it like the movie The Matrix. You know, Neo cannot help anybody escape the Matrix as long as he is still plugged into it. Right, he has to wake up and realize, oh my gosh, I'm plugged into something. I need to unplug from it. I need to go and live a life outside of it, and understand what was going on. and then he can go back in another way and help wake people up and say, hey, guys, wake up. You're part of something that's manipulating you, controlling you, you know, and you need to get out of this. But as long as Christians are part of the culture, we can't convert the culture. We can't help anybody else escape it. And really, that's why one of the reasons I wrote the book, I want Christians to recognize that patriotism and nationalism and being involved in politics is part of the way we are still part of the matrix. We're still part of the system, and we need to escape that and repent of that and get away from that and really completely and fully pledge allegiance to Jesus. He's our king. The only nation we have any loyalty to is his nation. And, you know, really, you know, focus on seeking first the kingdom of God. That's what we need to do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Speaking of what you were just talking about, pledging allegiance, we all know beginning of last football season, today is the crescendo of the National Football League world. But in the beginning of the season, we had a player,
yep,
Colin Kaepernick, who decided to take a knee during the national anthem. And people lost their collective mind. How dare you not stand up and represent Old Glory?
Yeah,
you know,
so disrespectful.
You not stand up for the Pledge of Allegiance to Christ. I will tell you, as a veteran of the United States Army, I stopped standing up for the Pledge of Allegiance a long time ago, way before Colin Kaepernick did it. But because I, you know, I'm just a guy at my kid's football game, you know, didn't make that much of attention. But I stopped doing it a while ago. Why? Because, one, I felt this country's not living up to its ideals, to its black citizens. And, two, is that my faith would not allow me to pledge allegiance to a flag. My allegiance is pledged to Christ himself. I will never pledge allegiance to a flag of the United States of America. What? And they indoctrinate you as a child in school, making you stand up before school day starts and recite that Pledge of Allegiance.
With your hand over your heart.
Yep. And, you know, you're exactly right, man. And honestly, that's when I saw what was going on with Colin and the backlash, you know, he was receiving and death threats and all kinds of stuff. You know, that was when I was writing my book. And so I was thinking, man, when my book comes out, I'm going to be the next guy that gets attacked. And I was expecting this huge backlash. And it hasn't come yet. The book's only been out. But I still expect it might come because when people really read my book and understand what I'm saying, I am saying don't pledge allegiance to the flag. You know, I am saying pledge your allegiance to Christ. And I know there are some people that are going to get really, really upset about that.
Mm-hmm. But they were in their feelings, man. They really wanted to crucify him. How dare you? You got better than die for that flag. No, they didn't.
So disrespectful. But so let me switch it up a little bit. Keith, do you believe that Christians should vote? And if they should or should not vote, and do you think that it's wrong for Christians to vote? And why?
Yeah, that's a good question, man. So, listen, I did not write this book to create some new set of laws and rules that I feel like Christians have got to do. And if you don't do this, you're a sinner.
Christian.
And if you do this, you're bad. I do not want anyone to take my book and use it as some kind of a rule book now that they've got to follow and they got to beat people else, somebody else over the head with, right? Here's how I would like to answer that question. I don't think the best question is should we or shouldn't we vote. I think what we should do as individual Christians is to take a step back and say, is voting, does my vote really make a difference? I talk about in the book how really in a lot of ways your vote doesn't really make a difference.
We sure did.
And participating in that political system, I mean, most of the problems this world has are spiritual problems. And what is the best way to really solve those problems, which are deeply spiritual? Is it voting or is it the gospel? And I think it's better for us to focus our time and our energy on, first of all, ourselves following Jesus and putting, you know, following him daily, and then we can be transformed by the gospel, and then to help other people around us also follow Jesus and become transformed by the gospel. I think that's a better plan. I think the fruit of that in the long run will be much, much better. Now, there could be, maybe there is a local issue where you realize, wow, this is an issue of justice. There's an injustice that needs to be corrected. If you went and voted for that, I don't think there'd be any major, I don't think God would be angry at you. But I caution Christians, however, I would still say with a caution, to not, what I want Christians to get is to understand that thing of voting, going into the voting booth and casting your vote, that is not the end of your responsibility as a follower of Christ to change the world. That is a blip. You have not, you don't sit down after doing that and say, well, there you go, I did it. No, you have not done really anything. You still have a calling to daily follow Jesus, put his words into practice, let him change your heart, and then go out and as the Spirit leads you, help people around you to know Jesus and help him also to be transformed by Christ. So, again, if you do vote, my warning or my challenge is don't get sucked back into that. Don't start thinking, man, that this is the best way to make a difference.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is we're at the top of the hour. We got about an hour left, and we are have on the line with us, on the show with us today, Mr. Keith Giles. He is the author of the book Jesus Untangled, and we are talking about politics and religion today. If you want to call in, the number is 929-477-1395. And if you call in, please don't call in at like 11:57. We're about to go off the air and, have like a lot of stuff to say. So if you want to call in, please call in. But we get a lot of callers sometimes, like to call at the very end of the show. But call in now if you got questions. I'm pretty sure Keith would not mind answering some of your questions about his book. All right, now Keith, even before we go any further, and we'll say this again at the end of the show, how can people get your book?
So the book is on Amazon. And so if you just go to Amazon.com and search Jesus Untangled, you'll find it. You can also go to, it's available on paperback and Kindle. You can also go to, there's a little book website. It's just JesusUntangled.com. And you can read about the book. There's a video you can watch there. You can even download an extended preview of the book for free. If you want to just read the first, 30% of the book, it's a pretty large chunk of the book that we're going to give away and let you just kind of get your feet wet, see what I'm talking about, and see if this is something you want to, go in and buy the book if you're curious about that. But, you can go to Amazon if you want to just buy the book, or you can go to JesusUntangled.com to learn more about it.
Mm-hmm. All right. John.
Yes. So, Keith, I have a question for you. How do you respond to people who bring up Martin Luther King Jr. and people like William Wilberforce using the political system to achieve a goal?
Yeah.
They're Christians.
Well, yeah. Well, that honestly, I'll be honest, guys, that was probably one of the most challenging parts of the book for me to wrestle with, to write. Because there is, I base a lot of my argument for why Christians should not involve themselves with politics on the New Testament and on the early Christian church before Constantine and their attitudes and the way they reacted to being involved in politics. But then, of course, we have in recent history, as you said, things like William Wilberforce, who was a Christian, who in England, over, a long, long struggle politically, overturned slavery in England without firing a shot, without bloodshed. I mean, they were able to end slavery without bloodshed. And then, of course, Martin Luther King Jr., who was a believer, who put the teachings of Jesus into practice, gave nonviolence and nonviolent resistance, and accomplished some really beautiful things in our country very recently to give rights to people who didn't have them and all that. So, yeah, I was challenged in the book to what do I say about that? What do I do about that? Well, here's the thing. I think it's kind of similar to what I just said a minute ago about the question about voting. Howard Zinn, a lot of people may not know him. He died a couple of years ago, but he was a really, really smart guy, really good historian, really, who studied world history. And he had a very interesting observation about the way things really work. He talked about these constitutional amendments in America that were passed to end slavery and to give people equal rights and give them equal protections under the law. And let me read this real quick, what he says about that. He says, you know, Congress may have passed these laws, but they did so for a good reason. Why? Not because Lincoln or Congress itself initiated them. No, they passed those amendments because a great movement against slavery had grown up in the country from the 1830s to the 1860s, a powerful anti-slavery movement which pushed Congress into the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. This is a very important thing to keep in mind, that when justice comes and when injustices are remedied, they're not remedied by the initiative of the national government or politicians. They only respond to the power of social movements. And that's what happened with the relationship between anti-slavery movements and the passage of those amendments. And so I think what he's putting his finger on is this. There's a difference between justice and politics. And the initiative, the change, does not come from the top down. It doesn't come from politicians. It comes from the people. If we as the body of Christ, if we, again, as followers of Jesus, stand up and speak truth to power and say, that's wrong, that's an injustice, that shouldn't be that way. We stand up with the people that are being oppressed. We advocate on behalf of them. We stand with them and say, this is wrong. I'm going to put myself at risk. I'm going to put myself in danger so that people, so that those who are weak and have no power can have power. I don't call that politics. I call that justice. And I think that's what we as followers of Jesus are called to do. But I think the danger is that Christians have only gone to the side of politics, which essentially amounts to I'm going to sit on my butt, I'm going to vote for a certain candidate, and think I've done it. I think I'm finished. Wilberforce himself, I went and studied a lot of what Wilberforce did and what he said. And when William Wilberforce wrote a book called A Practical View of Christianity, and in his book, he encourages Christians to make a difference. But here's what he says about how they should make a difference. He says, let true Christians boldly assert the cause of Christ in an age when so many are ashamed of him, and let them consider as passed down on them the important duty of suspending for a while the fall of their own country and perhaps of performing a still more extensive service to society at large, not by busy interference in politics, in which it cannot be confessed that there is much uncertainty, but rather by that sure and radical benefit of restoring the influence of religion and of raising the standard of morality. So William Wilberforce, yes, William Wilberforce did, as a Christian and as a politician, he worked for years to overturn slavery in England, and that was a good thing. But he himself, after that, said to brothers and sisters, said to us, here's what you really need to do. Don't bother yourself. Don't distract yourself in politics. Instead, go and preach the gospel. Go and live out the gospel. Go and make a difference in your community. And he understood that real change and real progress is going to be made if the church acts like the church. If we look like Jesus, if we act like Jesus, if we influence other people around us in the community to look like Jesus and act like Jesus, that is where real change is going to come. Let me use another example of what I'm saying. we can look at King David, right? And I've had Christians tell me this. But Keith, you know, you're saying that God doesn't care about government, God doesn't care about politics, but what about King David, right? He was actually a king, and he was a man after God's own heart. And God, you know, God did wonderful things through King David. So therefore, and we do this all the time, we play this little game where we say, well, therefore that must mean that God is in favor of politics. God is in favor of kings and kingship. But that's a mistake. And I think we make the same mistake by looking at William Wilberforce and saying, well, because God did some good things through Wilberforce, therefore God is in favor of that political system. That's a mistake. Because in the case of King David, why was there a king at all? Well, if you back it up, the guy that was king before David was Saul. And before Saul, there were no kings. For, you know, 1,000 years, there were no kings. And the reason why is that God was their king. And when the people finally got their way and they told the prophet Samuel, we want a king like all the other nations have, God's response to that was, they have rejected me as their king. Because what they wanted was a man to rule over them politically. And so let's understand this. These political systems are not God's idea. These political systems are a way of saying to God, we reject you as our king. We want someone else to rule over us. We as followers of Jesus cannot tell God, God, yes, we love you and we follow you. However, we want to elect a king or a president or a government. We want them to rule over us rather than you. When Jesus came, he came preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He announced a kingdom. It's another nation. Peter even calls it a holy nation. And that's the church. That's mm-hmm. the body of Christ. We need to pledge allegiance to the nation of Jesus. We need to have a loyalty to our rightful ruler, who is not the president. It's Jesus. And we have to understand that according to Scripture, our allegiances are either to God or they're to a worldly power. I also talk about in the book how, you know, in Revelation, the enemies of Jesus are the kings and the nations of the earth. It doesn't say the bad ones. It says all of them, all the kings of the earth, all the nations of the earth, because the kings and the nations of the earth are not following Christ. But if we are following Christ, we have to commit ourselves to him, commit ourselves to the gospel, submit ourselves to him as our king. Again, you know, the early Christians were put to death because they refused to say that Caesar was Lord. They said, Jesus is Lord. And because they refused to say that Caesar was Lord, they were tortured, they were put to death. Because they were put to death saying, we have no king but Jesus. Mm. And that needs to be our... That needs to be our, you know, battle cry today. That needs to be the beat of our heart today to say that, no, our king really is Jesus, not a metaphor, not pretend. He really is our king. I'm an ambassador of his kingdom. And, you know, ambassadors do not pledge allegiance to the nation that they serve. That's considered treason. They don't vote in the elections of the nation that they serve because that would be considered treason. They are loyal to the death to their nation, and our nation is the nation of Jesus.
It should be. Go ahead.
Let me ask this real quick. Is it okay? You think it's perfectly fine because as being American citizens to use our rights as American citizens to protect ourselves, like Paul did when he was going to be whipped, and they stopped him because he said, "Is it lawful for you to whip a Roman citizen?" Is it okay to use our citizenship to our advantage?
I think, yeah, that's an example. I don't think that example is necessarily something bad that we would say, oh yeah, you know, that was a bad idea. Paul shouldn't have done that. I mean, frankly, he did it because, I mean, like most of us in that situation would prefer not to be beaten. Although Paul was beaten many times, and he talks about this in one of his other letters about how many times he received the 40 lashes minus one And he says, you know, I bear on my body the marks of Christ. So, yes, in that particular case that you're talking about, he appealed to the soldier as a Roman citizen for protection. But in many other cases, he did not, and he did take it. I would ask this other question, though, because I think we may be it's very likely that Christians in America today are about to face another question, and that is, so your question is, you know, is it okay to use our rights as American citizens to escape, you know, being beaten or tortured or treated unfairly? And I think, yeah, that's probably okay. But I would ask a different question. What if we gave up our rights as Americans so that we could share in the sufferings of other people? And I say that because I think it could be likely, if nothing else, based on the history of our own country, what we did in World War II when we, you know, we created internment camps for the Japanese and for Germans, and we put American citizens, because of their nationality, we basically imprisoned them. We created concentration camps for them because of who, you know, their skin, because of their nationality. Well, we have a Muslim ban going on. We have at least a momentum that looks like what we're getting ready to do, if no one stops it. We very, very likely we could be in a scenario where people who are Muslim get arrested, get isolated in some way, lose their rights. And I would say, as followers of Jesus, would we be willing to give up our rights as American citizens to say, you know what, okay, I'm a Muslim. Why don't you put me in a camp with those people? Why don't you put me, let me suffer alongside those people? And use that as an opportunity to preach the gospel to those people in those camps, to show them who Jesus really is. That is the kind of question that excites me. That's the kind of question that makes me wonder, okay, would we be willing to do that? And I think there's a precedent for that in Scripture. Paul says, you know, to those who are under the law, I live as someone who's under the law. And to those who are not under the law, I live as someone who is not under the law. And why do I do that? So that many will be saved. In other words, his motivation is, the question is not, well, am I under the law or not under the law? No, the question is, what is it going to take for someone to be saved? And am I willing to live a certain way, to identify myself with a certain group of people so that they might hear the gospel and they might know the good news? I think we might one day be in a situation where Christians are faced with that choice. And are we willing then to say, you know what, I'm going to give up my rights to go and stand with those people over there who are being oppressed unjustly and use that as an opportunity to show them who Jesus really is?
Wow. Ooh, I don't know if we collectively as a body of Christ, and when I say, well, I'll say the American church, I don't think that we can do that. As an American church, you know, evangelicals, because if we could have done it, we would have been done it by now. You know, because
yeah.
we see a lot of mistreatment going on in this country right now, and you know, we turn a blind eye to it. Martin Luther King, I think when he was in jail, the letters from prison or whatever, when he wrote to the white evangelicals.
Birmingham,
letters from the Birmingham jail. You know, he could have did it right then and there. You know, you can turn on TV and see people getting sprayed down with water hoses and chewed up by dogs, you know, and you can watch that and you call yourself a true Christian? I don't get it. And Keith, like I said, I don't know if we as American Christians, and I'm using this generally, you know, a general term. You know, if we can do that, man, that's you're asking a lot, Keith.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, I agree with you. I think the scenario I just described to you would be a real test of faith for Christians. You know what I mean? It's one of these things where now we'll find out who's really following Jesus and who isn't. And I certainly would not expect the majority of of Christians in America to give up their rights and stand with the oppressed and be willing to go to one of these, you know, prisons or camps or something to preach the gospel to Muslims. But you know what? I'll bet you there's at least, you know, there's a handful of them. I do know there are some individual Christians who would. And I'll tell you right now, I'm going to go on record and say, I hope I'm one of them. I hope I have the courage to do that. I would want to be one of the Christians who would be willing to do that. Because I think we are living in a time where, you know, these are the kind of things that we may be called upon to do. This is like a moment of truth. I feel like, you know, we've got to put up or shut up. We've got to decide, are we really following Jesus, and how far are we willing to follow him? Are we willing to follow him to the death? Are we willing to follow him, you know, or are we just, like we've been talking about all morning, is it all about my comfort? Is it all about, well, I'm in my comfort zone here, and what you're talking about takes me out of my comfort zone, so I don't want to do that. Well, I got some bad news for you. Jesus is totally about everything he's about is living outside the comfort zone, right? Almost nothing gets accomplished in your house, on your living room, you know, on your couch, you know, in your little snuggie, watching the Super Bowl. That's not where faith happens. That's not where the kingdom advances. The kingdom advances when you are out of your comfort zone, in a place you're going, how did I get here? And your prayer is, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, help me. What do I do? Give me the words to say. Tell me what I'm supposed to do. You know, lead me, Holy Spirit. I'm just going to trust you and cling to you right now in this moment. That's where the kingdom comes. That's where the gospel, you know, the rubber hits the road. It's in situations like that are uncertain, and we don't know what's going to happen, and all we've got is Jesus, and then we find out, is he enough?
I even dare to say that time is actually here now. We don't even have to wait for the future, because we see the oppression of African Americans in this country, and very few of the evangelical Christians stand up and say anything. You see people getting murdered in the streets by cops, and they don't say anything. They won't say a word. But if you bring up abortion and gay marriage, they're the staunchest allies against it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I mean, gosh, have we not been through the last couple of years, you know, this season, where almost every other day you turned on the news and there was here's another black man, typically a black man, unarmed, shot to death by police, and no charges filed, and you know the guys are, you know, off, the grand jury rules that he acted in accordance with the law, and blah blah blah, and one after the other. I mean, even to the point where you have a little 12-year-old boy in a park playing with a toy gun who gets, you know, totally blown away within 10 seconds by a cop, and no charges, right? It's just you see that over and over and over and over again, and you start to wonder what's going on, right? We have a problem. We have a serious problem in our nation, and not a lot of Christians standing up to say, let's solve the problem. And in fact, the most disheartening thing I see is when Christians do speak out about things like that, they take the side of the people in power. They don't stand with the oppressed. They don't stand with the oppressed, which is, Jesus was always on the side of the one being oppressed. He was never on the side of the people in power. In fact, he had the harshest words for the religious people who were in power, who stood with the oppressors. And so we, as followers of Jesus, we have to stand with people who are suffering. We have to stand with the victims. That's where Jesus is.
Yeah.
All right, let's switch it up again just a little bit. We got about a little more than 30 minutes left. What are your beliefs? Because I think when I was reading your book, chapter 10, like, really had me, you know, thinking about the thing. I think chapter 10, you titled it The Power of Fear. And you talk about military and all this good stuff. And, you know, it really had me thinking, what is your I'm sorry, I don't know if you talked about the military in chapter 10 or not. But chapter 10 was about the power of fear. But Christians in the military, what is your belief on that?
Yeah, well, again, it's one of these things where my goal is not to create rules to say, hey, Christians, you got to be like this, and if you're not like this, you're not real Christians or anything like that. But what I do say is, when you read, especially, well, I think when you read the words of Jesus, it's pretty obvious. But when you then read the early Christian, first, second, third century, and you see unanimously across the board, everything they wrote about, everything they said was that Christians could not be a part of the military. And that if you became a Christian and you were in the military, you had to renounce your military service. And if you didn't, you weren't allowed to share communion. You weren't allowed to come to the Lord's table. And if you were in the government, you weren't allowed to be a part of the fellowship. And that was a pretty radical, that was a pretty hardcore posture. So for me personally, here's what I can say about where I stand. When I read the words of Jesus, and I see Jesus saying that when it comes to my enemy, I'm supposed to love them. Well, I'm supposed to turn the other cheek. I'm supposed to bless those who hate me and do good to those who want to hurt me and overcome evil with good. It's really hard for me then to turn around and say that it's okay for me to shoot someone. I think especially when it comes to the military, because, again, part of the entanglement is this, there's a story that we're told. There's this story that we're told about the military that the military is doing when they are sent overseas to go and fight in a war. And what they're doing is they're protecting the Constitution. They're standing up for freedom. They're fighting for the American way. They're standing for, free markets and freedom and capitalism and all that, democracy and all that. But that isn't the truth. That isn't really why we send troops to fight wars. It really has never been the reason we send troops to fight wars. We have always sent troops to fight wars to protect typically corporate interests, people, billionaires, people who had a whole lot of money to make, who had a lot, and they're the ones who really have all the power. And so the reality is that's what's happening. And let me back up. I shared a minute ago about how Paul said in 1 Corinthians that Christians were not to divide over their preference for one apostle over the other apostle. And so if that is the reality, if I'm not allowed to divide my fellowship with a brother or sister in Christ because we disagree about which apostle is the greatest, well, then I don't think then I can, under that same principle, I don't think it's okay for me then to join the military of my government, take a weapon, fly over to another nation, and kill some people who might also be my brothers and sisters in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when Paul was going around persecuting the church, when he was still Saul, Jesus appears to him on the road and says to him, Saul, why do you persecute me? It's hard for me when you kick against the pricks, right? In other words, what you're doing to these Christians directly, physically hurts Jesus. So now if that's the case with Saul, Chaim wasn't a Christian. He wasn't even a Christian, right? He was a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus appears to Saul and says, what you're doing to Christians directly hurts me. All right, now, think about that when someone puts a gun in your hand and says, for America, go over there to this other country and kill a bunch of people or drop some bombs on some people who might be your brothers and sisters in Christ. What would Jesus say to you? I think he would say, why do you persecute me? It hurts me when you shoot people who love me. It hurts me when you drop bombs on people who love me. Because, look, there's collateral damage in every war. We have no way of knowing. And I'll promise you, plenty of Christians have been killed, even in Middle Eastern countries. There are Christian populations even in Middle Eastern countries. There are Christians in Palestine. There are Christians in Iran. There's Christians in Iraq. There's Christians in Syria. There's a large Christian, actually, in each of those countries. And so if I, as a member of my military, go under the orders of my president and I engage in a military conflict, I should not want to be putting myself in a position where I may knowingly or unknowingly kill someone who is a brother or sister in Christ. Beyond that, I would say, why would you want to kill someone who's not a Christian yet? Because now you've just prevented that person from hearing the gospel.
Uh-oh.
If you hadn't killed them, they could have become a Christian. They could have become your brother or your sister in Christ. But you killed them before they had the chance. I just don't think that it's part of following the way of Christ to engage ourselves in something where the goal of the job is to kill people. I just don't think that's what the gospel is all about.
Okay. All right. John, do you have any questions? Because I had a few more, but. Nope.
No, go ahead.
Okay, Keith, I know you talked earlier about you not really receiving a lot of flack for the book yet. Have you received any flack at all, like either on Facebook or Amazon reviews or anything about that? Have you received anything whatsoever that you know of?
Well, I do have, and I have, like I said, I've been blogging on this topic for quite a while, so I definitely have my trolls who delight in, you know, making little snarky comments and challenging me on everything. And the problem is, you know, with a lot of these guys, we've just danced around and around and around and around these kind of arguments to the point where I can do the argument without them. I already know what they're going to say. I'm going to say this, and they're going to say that, and then I'm going to say this, and they're going to say that. And we've been around and around so many times. I have gotten some pushback a little bit. Not on Amazon. All the reviews so far have been really positive. Hopefully they'll stay that way. The kind of pushback that I get from Christians, and again, it's always Christians. I've so far never had a non-Christian argue with me on this issue. I think people that aren't Christians understand, like, yeah, of course, you're following this Jesus guy who is all about, you know, loving your enemy and doing good to those who hate you, and why would you be involved in, you know, all this other stuff? So it's usually always Christians who argue with me about this stuff. And I think one of the ironic things that I've noticed is that they accuse me, this has just been recently, you know, some Christians will accuse me of majoring on the minors. Like, oh, Keith, why are you, why are you going on and on about this issue about politics? You should just be focused on the gospel. You know, you're just being distracted. And then I'll go and look at that person's Facebook page who said that, and, you know, the banner at the top of their Facebook page is a picture of Donald Trump. And I scroll down their posts, and for the last 2 weeks, every single post they have posted has been something about politics. And I say, well, gee, I'm not sure I'm the one who's distracted by politics. You know, it's the irony of, like, it's a blind spot, really. And we all have blind spots. And the thing about blind spots is, you know, you don't see it, and you need someone to help you point it out. But it's also, you know, Jesus talks about the speck in your brother's eye and the log in your own eye. You know, guys, this idea of entanglement was the log in my eye for a long, long time. I mean, I was raised Republican, voted straight ticket Republican, voted for Reagan both times. You know, I listened to Rush Limbaugh. I was a member of the NRA. I was deep, deep, deep in this thing, and I thought there was nothing wrong with it. I thought, this is what it means to be a Christian, man.
God and country.
You know, God and country, man. God, guns, and guts made America great. And, you know, that's what I thought it was all about. And so it's really only been maybe the last, I don't know, maybe over the last 10 years or so, I've slowly, you know, God's grace has revealed to me the different places that I was entangled, the different ways my faith was compromised, the ways I really wasn't seeking first the kingdom of God. I was kind of seeking first the kingdom of America. And so, you know, now that I've realized how much I was entangled, that writing the book is my way of trying my best to really as lovingly as possible. I went out of my way because I know this is a volatile issue. This is a hot button topic. you know, the two things you never talk about when you get together with your family, right, is religion and politics. And I'm writing a whole book about religion and politics. So I get that this is a difficult topic for many people. So I did my best to be as gentle as I could talking about this issue. But I know, you know, so far I think I've been really blessed. Most of the feedback I've gotten has been really positive. Most of the emails I've gotten from people privately have been people telling me, you know, thank you for setting me free. Thank you for opening my eyes. Thank you for showing me the ways I was entangled that I didn't realize I was. And that's beautiful. And that's why I wrote the book. That's what I'm hoping for. I mean, I don't want to get into arguments with people. I don't want to create some kind of controversy. That's not my desire at all. I really, really just want people, my brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, you know, I want them to recognize they're wasting their time and their energy on politics, and in the meantime, the gospel is just laying there, and nobody's preaching it, nobody's living it, no one's really as excited about Jesus as they are about their political leader and their political platform. And I think that's something I want the church to get back to. I want the church to come back around and remember her first love, who is Christ, right? Seek first the kingdom of God, and that's what we're called to do. So that's my hope. I'm hoping that the book will accomplish that. And again, if anyone listening to this program, you want to talk about it, you know, find me on Facebook, go to my blog, keithchiles.com. Let's talk about it. You know, again, my goal, again, is not to argue. I really do want to help people process this stuff and come out of it, you know, like I did, and recognize there's a whole lot more freedom. There's a whole lot more joy that when you can, you know, untangle yourself from politics, you can kind of not stress out anymore about all this stuff and really just focus on Jesus and his plan to change the world. It's really just, it's much, much better. So that's my hope.
Okay. Okay. We got a couple of callers. But right before we take the callers, I do want to promote his book. It's called Jesus Untangled. You can get it at Amazon. He said it's also available on Kindle. So please go check out this book. Get this book. It is very, very good. It's an easy read. So area code 708-708. You are live on Real Talk Radio with Keith Giles. What is your name and your comment, please?
Yes. Excuse me. This is Lynn calling. I appreciate the show. I really enjoy the topic, and I enjoy all of you and the host and the author.
Thank you.
What he has been stating has been a staple in believers' lives for many years. I would say up until the Reagan administration, Bush, they brought in this thing of bringing the church in. I think with Jerry Falwell and, you know, the moral majority and all of that stuff came in. See, I'm probably older than all of you, and I remember the evolution of that. When we were coming up in the church, politics and religion were separated. It didn't mean that you were told not to vote or anything like that, but it wasn't really discussed. You know, you knew you had civic duties, so to speak, like going to jury duty. I mean, if you were drafted, you went into the military or whatever, but it wasn't to the extent as it is now, and I have seen it progressively over the years come to where it is now, where the author is speaking of, where it's just ridiculous. It's ridiculous to see Christians having a whole discussion about politics. That never was, and it never was to be. And I remember, you know, when we came up in the church, it was never discussed. Now you have churches that bring politicians into their pulpit, and the pulpit was always sacred. You know, you didn't bring everybody couldn't just step up there in that pulpit, you know, because it was considered you're in God's house, and this is a holy place. Not that it's a shrine or anything like that, but you had that sort of reverence that you don't have now. Now they're bringing in the mimes and the dancers and, as one stated, the comedian shows and all of that stuff. And they're bringing all the politics in. So this has been an evolution of this apostate state that our church is in. And it's just gone rapid. It's crazy. And it's really an embarrassment on Christianity. Yeah. I mean, even with the people that Trump has put behind him, that are supposed to be evangelicals. If you search and research their bios and research their backgrounds, you'll see that they're a joke, you know. So Christianity now is a joke. And as your author has said, we have to get back to the basics. We have to get back to where we were and start from there again, you know. And in terms of saying the Pledge of Allegiance, when we did that growing up, at that time, God was at the forefront, you know, was even in our allegiance. So you didn't have any sort of feeling where you didn't want to do it or why am I doing it? You felt proud of your country, this country of freedom, which we still have, which we're utilizing right now on this blog talk, on this free internet. And we were happy about that. It doesn't mean that we were brainwashed or anything like that. And God was the center of that allegiance. It was always in the back of your mind as a kid, well, my dad and mom are teaching me about God and my country is for God. So you didn't have any qualms about it. I can understand now they've taken God out of the allegiance. They don't even do the Pledge of Allegiance. So I can understand people saying, well, I'm not even going to stand up for it anymore, you know. So things have changed. That's why people have changed, and they don't want to do the Pledge of Allegiance. Our country's like this. Yes, we have so many faults, but we also have so many goods. And we're a people that can work, that we work together, all the cultures and races together has what and God has made this country as it was. We give out millions of dollars to help people in other countries. They look to us. And God has blessed us for that. We have been a blessed country, despite all of its ills and all the faults and things that it's going through right now that are wrong. But he still had blessed us. And we're even blessed right now that we can talk on this blog talk like we do and the freedoms that we still have. And another one more thing about the military, if you're a Christian and you feel a certain way, then don't join the military. They don't have the draft anymore. You know, in Vietnam War, they had the draft. They were drafting guys left and right. They drafted my brother. Well, he became a religious objector. And they do have those clauses where you can just not have a gun if you don't need to. Or because I know he didn't go in because of that. You have to get proof and you have to get your pastor to sign papers and things of that nature during that time. That was during when it was – when you had to go in, but now it's voluntary. So if you don't want to deal with any of that, what the author was talking about, then you don't join. You know, no one's making you, and you can still do your civic duty and still have a nationalistic sort of feeling about your country. And thank you so much for this opportunity, and thank you for your show.
Thank you, sis. Appreciate it. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, I appreciate the call, and I want, man, She hit on a couple of really good things. I think the thing she said at the end, I think, and I don't go into it in the book very much. I'm writing a follow-up book at the moment, and probably the follow-up book I will address this because this what she said about, you know, going into the military, we don't have a draft anymore. You don't have to go into the military, and so if you don't have that conviction, you don't have to do that. And I know that is true to a degree. I think it's true if you're a middle class to upper class, if that's where you live, you live in the middle class or the upper class, absolutely not. You do not have to join the military. However, our military aggressively recruits low-income communities, communities where there are people who are really, really poor, where they don't, you know, if they graduate high school, they do not have an option to go to college. They probably can't go to trade school. And they will go to those high schools, and they will aggressively, and I mean aggressively, recruit these kids to join the military because they have no other choice. It's either work at McDonald's or join the Air Force or join the Marines or join the Army or join the Navy. And so you're right. No one's forcing you. There's no draft. We certainly have I think it's an injustice. I think we have created, I don't think it's an accident. We have created pockets of poverty within our nation where a lot of those young people really do not have a choice. Their choices are join the military and get possibly a college education, but they're going to have to sign up for the military to do that. Or, you know, sit around on the couch and drink beer and, you know, watch American Ninja Warrior because you don't really have any other choice unless maybe you're a mechanic or whatever. But you're not going to be able to earn a lot of money to start a family. You really don't have a future. And so joining the military for a lot of poor communities, that is your best option. And I think it's actually, again, I think that's on purpose. I think it's one of the ways we don't have a draft on paper, but in a kind of in a way we have the same result. We have a community of people who don't, we've given them no other choice except the military.
Mm-hmm. All right, Keith, we got one more caller. This will be the last caller, and we'll go ahead and end the show after this caller. Area code 412, 412, you're live on Real Talk Radio. I think this is Leonard from Pittsburgh.
Yeah, this is.
But you're live with Keith Giles. What's up, Lenny?
Hey, first of all, I'm really enjoying the show today. This is actually a very good show. And as a political junkie and the resident liberal in the place, I really feel like there have been some places where I agree, and then there's some other places where I am totally convicted. And I appreciate the conviction, you know. Real quick, before I get going here, I remember reading a book about 5 or 6 years ago. It was called Patience with God, and it was Frank Schaeffer. And I think he's like an atheist now. I'm not necessarily sure of his faith level or anything like that, but I was reading the book, and it brought some historical significance to me, because when you guys started talking about the moral majority, he broke down his father's relationship, who was Francis Schaeffer, and his cohort in that, you know, being Jerry Falwell, and how they purposely, and when, you know, when you're talking about it, you got to understand that the level of, you know, the depth in which they wanted to overtake the political process. And I found it very interesting in that. All right, go ahead, Keith.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm just agreeing with him. I quote Frank Schaeffer in my book, and I go through that entire process of how his father, working with Jerry Falwell and Ed Dobson and Cal Thomas and all those guys, I'm just agreeing with you. That's exactly right. That is exactly what happened.
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, it's funny how, and it took just a generation to do it, to where everyone, and you know, especially it seems like everyone, had went over to one political party over the other. And it brings me to my little story here. When I was in the church, I had tried to integrate a white church in my neighborhood, which was, you know, for predominantly mixed neighborhood. And I was, you know, on staff just trying to bring in other, you know, black folk into the church and being a pastor. And one of our staff meetings, we were at someone's house and, you know, we're just fellowshipping and, you know, talking about what was going on in, you know, whatever church business we needed to take care of. And this is in 2004. And we were talking during the course of the conversation. Politics comes up, you know, as usual. And someone asked, you know, my thoughts on, you know, Bush Kerry. And, you know, and I'm going in on how I'm supporting John Kerry. Well, one of the mothers of the church, right, little sweet old lady, I love Miss Ellen. Ellen was a great woman. And she born, you know, so the conversation moves on, and it was about 5 or 10 minutes later. She comes over and sits next to me on the sofa. And she leans into me and whispers in my ear, said, "Are you a Democrat?" And I said, "Yes." And she, with the serious in her whisper, and said, "But if you're a Christian, how can you be a Christian as a Democrat?"
Right. Yep.
You know. So.
Oh yeah.
I was just
that is exactly a similar conversation that my parents and I had during. It's funny because it was John Kerry too. It was the same thing with John Kerry. Where how can you be a Christian and vote for John Kerry? And it was like, are you kidding me?
Mm-hmm.
But that's probably the first time I realized how strong the entanglement really was in my own family and in myself. That, yeah, you know,
yeah.
What's wrong? Why are we deciding who's a Christian based on who you vote for? That was never, ever a test in the Christian church. You know, you're a Christian based on who you vote for.
Mm-hmm. And I'd always, and growing up, I was, like I said, I was a political junkie. I voted in every election except for primary election in 2013. And I hold pride to that, you know, and... You know, growing up, I always realized, even within my faith, that, you know, religion was one thing and politics was another thing, and I didn't really want those two things to meet. But as you can see, that has totally changed, because now it seems like you're, whether or not you are a, you know, believer in Christ, you're one party. Then the party will sit up there and tell folks that, If you're a Christian, you're not the other party. And I've heard that so much over the past few years, to the point where, you know, we've had this, I mean, we've gone through 8 years of hearing that our president was, you know, the Antichrist. He's a Muslim, he's this, he's that. You know, and then we get to this other thing where now, oh, wow, now he's the next best thing to Jesus. You know, and you see all these different memes and stuff. It's just astonishing. And I'm just going to leave it at that because I'm about ready to drop off. But revolution, everybody, and I appreciate, and I'm definitely going to get your book because, you know, I love politics anyways, and this seems like this is right up my alley. The revolution, everybody.
Okay. All right. Appreciate you, Lenny.
Yeah. Hey, Leonard. Right. And when you do read the book, Leonard, please let me know what you think. I would love to continue talking with you about it after you read the book.
Okay. Yeah, he's Facebook friends with us, Leonard. So you can get – I don't know if you're friends with him yet, but you can get him from me or John's friend list. It's about time to end the show. You got any last words, Keith?
Well, I think everything we've talked about today, hopefully it's stirred people's hearts, you know, and helps them kind of really think about this from a different point of view. My heart's desire really is I want Christians, again, to just pledge allegiance to Christ and to him and his kingdom, to recognize that we already have a king, we're already citizens of another nation that transcends all borders, and that, you know, to be a follower of Jesus has nothing to do with being Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, or anything else. Really, our allegiance is to Christ. And the only hope for this planet is Jesus and his gospel and his kingdom. And we have to focus on that. We have to just commit ourselves completely to him for our own sake, for our own life, but also for the lives of people around us. So that's my hope. I hope people will read the book, and I'm open to people who want to dialogue about the book as they read it or after they read it.
All right. John, any last words?
Yeah. My last little thought is that, you know, that politics is really about power and the power
yep.
to change things and the power to control things. They want to change things. They want to change the world through their political power. But the ultimate power, the same power that raised Christ from the dead, is the same power that lives in us. And so the power we have is the power of the gospel, the power of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we preach the gospel, then we can change people's hearts. And once people's hearts change, then we can change the culture by changing the hearts of the people. And once we change the culture, we can change the whole world. But we have
Amen.
To use the right power source, and that's the power of the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Rob.
I feel like we went to church today.
Well,
in a good way.
Ready to take up
the
tithes and offerings? Rob, any last words, Rob? No? Okay. Keith, is it
all
right?
I was on mute, man. My fault. I just
okay.
wanted to thank Keith again, you know, for coming on the show. And I'd encourage everybody to check the book out. I plan on definitely giving it a very thorough read myself. And I've enjoyed you on the show, man. So thanks again for coming on.
Thank you, man.
All right.
God bless.
All right. And I'll say this. You don't want a theocracy, a Christian theocracy, because then they'll pass laws that say that you have to pay tithes. So think
Amen.
About that.
yep.
Is it okay if I quote a couple of lines from your book, Keith?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Because this is what really got me. And this is at the end of the book. You said, but there are also a few things I will ask you not to do. First, please do not make it your mission to argue with other Christians about how wrong they are to mix their faith and their politics. And skipping down, even more importantly, please don't look down upon our brothers and sisters in Christ who are still entangled. Don't get angry with those who pledge allegiance to the flag or who confuse their political party with the kingdom of God. Don't treat Christians in the military as if they are not true Christians. Don't act as if those who vote are less spiritual than you. And I think that was very important for you to say that. You said it a few times, you know, not precisely like that, but you talked about that particular thing a few times. And I think that, you know, you're showing the compassion for other believers,
yeah.
which I think a lot of times we, especially those who when you first come out of the church, you know, you lose a lot of compassion for those people who are still in the church. And I think that was very important for you
yeah.
to say that in
Amen.
That book.
Amen. Absolutely, man. Because you know what? The last thing, the goal is not to create more division. The goal is reconciliation and unity in Christ. And again, if we're really going to be set free and untangled from these things, the end result, we'll know we're really untangled if the end result is we love more people and we have more unity. You know, the way it should be is that we only see people who God loves, and therefore we only see people that we love. And it doesn't matter what label they have or what their condition is, even if they're not even Christians, all we see are people to love. And people that God
right.
loves. So, amen. Amen.
Right.
Thank you for
amen.
Sharing.
Amen. All right, Father, we just thank you for allowing us to have this conversation on the show today. We pray that something was said that will prick some hearts, Father God, but most of all, we want you to get the glory, because it's never about us. It's always about you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. We thank Keith
yeah.
for joining us today. Every time this man calls, we always have a great show. And we love to have him on as a guest. Don't forget to get his book, Jesus Untangled, on Amazon.com. You can get the paperback. Did you say it was a hard copy, hardcover too?
Not a hardcover. There's a paperback and a Kindle.
Paperback and a Kindle. So get the book, please. It's a very, very good read. Join us next week. I think we're talking I don't know what we're talking about. Not next week. We're doing every other week now. So please join us. In 2 weeks. We love you guys, and we will see you in 2 weeks. Peace.
Thank you for listening to this week's episode of Real Talk Radio. Check out our website at www.4realtalkradio.com for updates on all of our social media platforms, including our YouTube channel and Facebook page. Feel free to send us any of your comments, questions, or criticisms. If this show or any of our past shows have helped you in any way, please feel free to share it with your friends and family. See you next week.
Welcome to Metro PCS.
Hi, I heard you're giving free phones to everybody?
Yes, right now everybody gets a free phone. You and your friends, cousins, neighbors, roommates.
What if I'm already with Metro PCS?
Yeah, it's for existing customers, new customers, people named Willie, dog lovers.
That's awesome.
Everyone gets a free phone at Metro PCS. Come choose your select free phone from brands like Samsung and LG. Metro PCS, wireless figured out. Sales tax not included. Phones free after instant and mail-in rebates. Upgrade fee may apply. Excludes numbers on the T-Mobile network. See store for details and terms and conditions.
It's tough to cope with asthma, diabetes, or COPD. If you are an adult and have one of these conditions, you may be at increased risk of getting pneumococcal pneumonia, even if you are a young adult. In some serious cases, pneumococcal pneumonia may be fatal and can strike anywhere. Compared to healthy adults, symptoms can be more severe and may take longer to recover from. Don't risk getting pneumococcal pneumonia. Ask your doctor if vaccination is right for you. Brought to you by Pfizer.